The BSON lecture series is a new series of monthly webinars which aim at the full integration of Palestine into the global learning community.
We sponsor discourses on subjects of cultural, scientific, and societal importance by leading research experts and public intellectuals of varied heritage and viewpoints.
These interactive webinars are free and open to the public, and recordings of each will be posted soon after the end of each lecture.
The BSON Center for Research and Development is a non-partisan civil society organization that was founded back in 1989. We work on connecting young scholars with the global community of research to contribute to the creation and establishment of these connections and this community of learning, where sciences of all forms can be used and utilized for the benefit of man.
The BSON Lecture Series is the response of the international academic community to the Israeli attacks against the inalienable right of the Palestinian people to education and academic freedom. We stand in solidarity with the six Palestinian NGOs targeted by the Israeli government, and through them, with the entirety of Palestinian civil society.
Welcome to all, wherever you are. Ahlan wa marhaban bikum aynama kuntum. If you prefer to hear this entire session in Arabic, please click on the icon in the shape of a globe at the bottom of your screen. إذا أردتم متابعة هذه الحلقة باللغة العربية بإمكانكم النقر أو الضغط على الرمز بشكل كرة أرضية في أسفل شاشة الكمبيوتر. I am Asaf Kfouri, a theoretical computer scientist at Boston University in the United States, and a member of the steering committee of the BSON Lecture Series. Before I introduce our guest speaker, Professor Mark Smith, a few words to put this lecture in context. The BSON Lecture Series is a joint project of two groups, Scientists for Palestine and the BSON Center for Research and Development. Of the two, Scientists for Palestine is an international organization with members spread over several countries in Europe, North America, and the Middle East. The other group, the BSON Center, is based in Ramallah in occupied Palestine and is therefore directly in harm's way. Indeed, any initiative of self-help by the Palestinian community is considered an act of terrorism by the Israeli authorities. And so the BSON Center, along with other non-governmental organizations, the occupied territories, are constantly in the Israeli army's crosshair just by virtue of being Palestinian. In its first meeting last Friday, the Committee on National Security of the new Netanyahu government issued a directive that, quote, action will be taken against organizations in Judea and Samaria that promote terrorist activity or any hostile activity, including political and legal action against Israel under the guise of humanitarian work. And 2 days ago, on Monday, the new Minister of National Security, Itamar Ben-Gvir, banned the display of the Palestinian flag in public spaces. But this is not new. It continues a decades-long policy of systematic erasure of Palestinian identity, though now more openly and brazenly. And so it goes. Let me now say a few words about our guest speaker. On behalf of the steering committee of the BSON Lecture Series, it's my privilege and honor to introduce Mark Smith, retired professor of history at the University of Missouri and distinguished scholar of the history of science. He's going to describe the famous moon illusion, an ancient optical mystery that continues to amaze us and puzzle scientists today. Mark will tell us how the Arab scholar Ibn al-Haytham sought to explain the puzzle in his book of optics, Kitāb al-Manāẓir, as a case study in how scientific ideas evolved from their predecessors. Al-Haytham wrote in the early 11th century and had a monumental influence on the subsequent development of science in medieval Europe, where he was known as Al-Hasin, and some of his work were translated into Latin. It's fair to say that Mark is the preeminent scholar of Al-Haytham. We know this because he has 50 citations in Al-Haytham Wikipedia article. And I know this on a personal note because when I informed George Saliba, who's in the audience today, emeritus professor of Columbia at Columbia University and himself a distinguished historian of science, he wrote back, quote, Mark has done more than anyone else on Ibn al-Haytham. And we know this also because Mark published the 8-volume definitive edition of the Latin text of the Book of Optics, including an English translation and critical commentary. The moon illusion is only a tiny piece of the work of the book, but Mark argued that it has much to tell us about the illusion in particular and about how science works in general. Before I turn the floor to Mark, a few matters of organization. The lecture will be about 45 minutes. After the lecture, there will be a question and answer session of about 20 minutes. At any time, you can write your question in the Zoom chat box in Arabic or in English. And during the question and answer, I will take the question in some order. I will read them aloud and Mark will answer them. Mark, welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Asaf. Let me set things up here. Okay. So let me again start with a very brief biographical sketch of Ibn al-Haytham. Unfortunately, what we know or think we know about Ibn al-Haytham's life and works is based almost entirely on two 13th century sources, both of them written long after his death and both of them problematic. One, for instance, refers to Ibn al-Haytham by the given name al-Hasan, the other by the given name Muhammad. And there are other inconsistencies as well, some of them significant. Consequently, it's difficult to establish the facts of his life with any certainty. The best we can do is proceed with caution. For a start, there's general agreement that Ibn al-Haytham was born in Basra, Iraq, sometime around 965, and died in Cairo around the very beginning of 1040. A gifted mathematician with an unusual flair for clear, systematic thinking, he wrote on a wide variety of technical subjects, from pure geometry and arithmetic to optics, astronomy, and cosmology. All told, he's credited with nearly 100 works on scientific subjects. A little more than half are currently extant in complete or partial form. By far, the longest and most influential of these works was the monumental Kitāb al-Manāẓir, or Book of Optics, which he likely composed in his later years. One of only two of his writings to have been translated into Latin during the Middle Ages, it appeared in that form under the title De Aspectibus, or On Visual Appearances, and was attributed to al-Hasan, a fairly accurate Latin transliteration of Ibn al-Haytham's given name. It's in this version, not the Arabic original, that the Kitāb al-Manāẓir gained widespread acceptance as a canonical source in optics during the later Middle Ages and Renaissance. It's also this version that I spent most of my academic career editing and translating. Consisting of 7 books, the Kitāb al-Manāẓir covers all aspects of vision from the physics of light to the physiology and psychology of visual perception. The resulting account, much of it supported by complex geometrical reasoning, is remarkably broad in scope, detailed in analysis, and sophisticated in approach. So much so that, on its basis, Ibn al-Haytham has earned a place among the most prominent scientific thinkers, not just of his day, but of all time. It's therefore upon the Kitāb al-Manāẓir that I'll focus in this brief talk. More specifically, I'll focus on Ibn al-Haytham's account of the moon illusion at the very end of that treatise. I've chosen to focus on this account for two reasons. First, because it requires no technical expertise to understand or appreciate. And second, because it exemplifies the ingenuity with which Ibn al-Haytham adapted, assimilated, and eventually transcended his sources. Briefly put, the moon illusion is based on the apparent magnification of the moon or sun as they descend toward the horizon. This is illustrated here, where the moon looks fairly small when seen high in the evening or night sky, and significantly larger when viewed near the horizon. We've all experienced this phenomenon, and when asked to estimate how much larger the moon or sun looks at horizon, many of us guess that they're at least twice as large, even larger in some cases. In fact, no such magnification takes place. The moon and sun are no bigger at horizon than directly overhead at zenith, both of them subtending an arc of about half a degree at the two points. Both celestial bodies, in short, subtend the same visual angle no matter where they are in the sky. At times, in fact, they can appear flattened and thus shrunken by atmospheric refraction at the horizon, as illustrated here, where the moon's shape is distorted by such flattening. Here we see the same effect with the sun, the result being that, like the moon, it appears somewhat oblate at the horizon. The problem, therefore, is to explain why the apparent enlargement occurs at horizon, and as we'll see, Ibn al-Haytham's solution depends on a rather sophisticated understanding of how we perceive distance and size. But in order to appreciate the elegance of that solution, we need to take a brief look at his key source, the Greco-Roman thinker Ptolemy, whose optics served as a template for the Kitāb al-Manāẓir. Key to Ptolemy's account of vision is the assumption that the eye, represented in this crude schematic, emits a sort of luminous flux passed into it through the hollow optic nerve from the brain. That flux is then radiated out along perfectly straight lines toward external objects, such as the one represented by the thick red line. Taken as a whole, these radial lines form a cone bounded by the pupil with its vertex in the center of the eye and its base defining the field of view. When they come into contact with visible objects in that field, the radial lines of flux feel them in a visual way. The resulting visual impression, which is grounded in the object's color, radiates back through those lines to the eye in the form of a sensible representation. This representation is then passed back through the optic nerve to the brain, where we make perceptual and intellectual sense of it. If, for instance, the lines of flux within the visual cone make contact with a horse, the impression arising from this contact is passed back to the eye in the form of an image loaded with implicit information that includes such things as its color, shape, location, size, and so forth. By perceptually and intellectually processing this information, we eventually realize that what we've seen is a horse and not a mule or an ox. In order to make full visual sense of what we see, we need to know how far away it lies and how large it is. According to Ptolemy, we determine the distance of things through an innate sense of how long the lines of luminous flux between us and those things are. Accordingly, we perceive that object B in this diagram is twice as far away as object A, because we sense that line of flux EB is twice as long as line of flux EA. The visual perception of distance is therefore immediate and intuitive for Ptolemy, who invites us to think of it by analogy to how we determine distance with our arms, hands, and fingers. Just as we judge how far away things are according to how far we have to reach out to touch them, so our luminous flux tells us how far away things lie according to how far it has to reach out in order to make visual contact with them. Likewise, just as our fingers and hands apprehend certain physical characteristics of things they touch, for example, what shape they are, whether they're smooth or rough, whether they're hard or soft, and so forth, so the luminous flux informs us about various physical characteristics of the objects it touches, such things as color, texture, shape, and so forth. Determining distance is also crucial to ascertaining the size of things, which is ultimately based on the visual angle they subtend. For instance, of two objects A and B in the same distance from the eye, the same distance from the eye, but subtend different visual angles, the one that subtends the larger angle will look larger, object B in this case. On the other hand, if the two objects lie at different distances from the eye, then the visual angle alone will be insufficient for determining size. That angle has to be correlated with distance. This is clear in the case of two objects A and B that lie different distances from the eye, but subtend equal visual angles. The one that lies farther away, namely object B, will look larger to us because we sense that it lies farther away. The virtue of this account of distance and size perception is its simplicity and its appeal to common sense. Most of us, I think, regard such perception as intuitive and immediate, as occurring automatically the instant we see something. Ibn al-Haytham, on the other hand, was forced to explain it in a more complex and sophisticated way, because unlike Ptolemy, who based his account of sight on luminous flux radiated out from the eye to visible objects, Ibn al-Haytham based his on the radiation of light from visible objects into the eye. In assimilating Ptolemy's ray theory, therefore, Ibn al-Haytham had to adapt it to his light-based theory of vision. So let's take a brief look at that theory, starting with his anatomical model of the eye. Here's a rough schematic of that model, and here it is beside a schematic of the eye according to current anatomical knowledge. As you can see, the two models are roughly similar in that they share the same basic components, that is the transparent cornea at front, the anterior chamber between the cornea and the front of the lens itself, the space behind the lens filled with vitreous humor, and the optic nerve at the back of the eye. Contrary to modern anatomical theory, Ibn al-Haytham followed the ancient Galenic medical tradition in assuming that the optic nerve is hollow. You can also see that the geometry of Ibn al-Haytham's eye is somewhat different from that of its modern counterpart. In his model, unlike the modern one, the front surface of the lens is perfectly concentric with the cornea, which in turn is perfectly concentric with the eye as a whole. Also, in Ibn al-Haytham's model, the optic nerve lies directly along the eye's axis, whereas it's offset from that axis in the current model. Now let's place an object in front of Ibn al-Haytham's eye, as represented here by the thick red line. According to Ibn al-Haytham, every point on that object radiates its light, or rather its luminous color, in every possible direction as represented here, where the top end point of the object sends rays out toward every point in the surrounding space that's open to it. Of all those rays, only one reaches the front surface of the cornea along the perpendicular, so when it passes straight through, it strikes the front surface of the lens along the perpendicular as well. This is dictated by the geometrical structure of the eye, as Ibn al-Haytham describes it. Being visually sensitive, the front surface of the lens feels the impinging ray in a way analogous to how we feel a small object striking our skin. It only feels those rays that strike it along the perpendicular, though, because they strike it most forcefully. The rest, being oblique, are too weak to be sensed. The resulting visual impression then passes straight through the lens toward the center of the eye in conformity with the eye's geometrical structure. The same holds for the radiation from these spots on the object. All of these rays, along with the infinitude of those between them, form a cone of light radiation with its vertex at the center of the eye and its base in the field of view. As is evident from a side-by-side comparison, Ibn al-Haytham's cone of light radiation is geometrically equivalent to Ptolemy's cone of visual flux. The only difference lies in the direction of radiation. Ibn al-Haytham's is inward toward the eye, Ptolemy's outward from the eye. So here we have a textbook example of adaptation and assimilation on Ibn al-Haytham's part. We also have a clear indication of how deeply indebted he was to Ptolemy in forming his own account of vision. Every ray within Ibn al-Haytham's cone of radiation makes a visual impression on the front surface of the lens, and all the resulting impressions pass as a whole and in proper order through the lens toward the center of the eye. On reaching the rear surface of the lens, they're refracted into the vitreous humor, and from there continue in proper order into the hollow optic nerve. Still in proper order, they pass through the optic nerve to the brain, where they're subject to perceptual and intellectual processing. Altogether, the visual impressions made by the impinging rays on the lens's front surface form a sort of mosaic or pointless representation of the objects in the field of view. That representation can be thought of by analogy to this famous work by the French artist Georges Seurat, who painted not with brush strokes, but by making innumerable pinpoints of color with the tip of his brush, which is obvious from the enlarged inset at the lower right of the slide. Like this painting, the visual representation formed on the lens's surface consists of infinitesimal dots of color, visible rather than physical color, juxtaposed in a flat two-dimensional array. So how do we determine distance according to this account of sight? Clearly, we can't do so through an innate sense of ray length, because instead of reaching out from us, the rays come to us from outside. It's as if we were being touched by someone else's finger rather than using our own to establish contact. Consequently, just as we can't determine by physical touch how far a projectile that hits us has traveled, we can't determine by visual sensation how far the luminous color that strikes our lens has traveled. This means that we can't sense distance intuitively or immediately, as Ptolemy's theory would have it. Distance perception must involve an interpretive process of some sort. As empirical proof that we don't perceive distance directly or immediately, Ibn al-Haytham offers the following experiment. Let this be a room inside of which two walls, B and C, are set upright so that wall C lies behind wall B and juts out beyond it to the right. This arrangement is represented here when seen from above and here when seen from the side. Bore a small opening or window in the outer wall of the room facing the two inner walls and place your eye at A so that you can see those two walls but not the room's sides, floor, or ceiling. In other words, assume that only the rays represented by blue lines and all the ones between them can reach your eye through the window. When you view the two walls under those conditions, as represented here, they'll appear to lie in the same distance and in the same plane, but contiguous to one another. In other words, wall C won't appear to lie behind wall B, but right next to it. Ibn al-Haytham's point is that far from being intuitive and immediate, distance perception depends on context. Or to put it another way, we infer distance from clues provided by the context within which we view things. Here's an example. Within this restricted framework, it's impossible to tell how these two upright poles are situated with respect to one another. In fact, they both appear to lie next to each other in the same plane. But in proper context, their spatial relation becomes clear according to various clues in the landscape, the way the poles are aligned with one another, the way they decrease in size from right to left, the way the scuff marks in the dust give the landscape texture, and the way the low hills in the distance provide a sense of spatial scope. On the other hand, in a virtually featureless landscape such as this, it's difficult, if not impossible, to gauge distances with any accuracy, especially as we look farther out toward the horizon. With all this in mind, let's return to our pointless painting. As we noted earlier, it's analogous to the two-dimensional visual image produced on our lens. Therefore, it contains no depth. Yet, from the various contextual clues provided in this two-dimensional representation, distances within it are fairly easy to determine. For instance, I'd estimate this distance to be around 5 meters, this one around 10, this one around 25 or 30, and this one close to 100. You may disagree with my numbers, but you'll all agree that they're in proper relative order and proportion. How then is it that we not only see, but actually estimate distances in a non-spatial representation like this? Ibn al-Haytham's response is as follows. When we first view the world as infants, all we see is a confusion of disparate colors without even recognizing what kinds of colors they are. Over time, though, repeated experiences teaches us to distinguish among not only colors, but also objects. In that way, we develop a taxonomy, according to which we distinguish red from blue or green, or horses from mules or oxen. This taxonomy is based on repeated perceptions of the same things or kinds of things from which we form general conceptual representations of them. These we store in memory as mental pictures of a sort. When we perceive new things, we compare them to these mental pictures in order to determine where they might fit into our taxonomy. As we gain mobility, Ibn al-Haytham continues, we begin to measure the outside world and the things in it according to bodily units, such as arm spans, arms lengths, or paces. with repeated perceptions of such things as humans, for instance, we apply these measures to them in order to determine their size, concluding that adult humans are, on average, one arm span tall. We then include that determination in our mental picture. With increased mobility, we begin to extend these measures to several arms lengths or paces away until we're able to judge reasonably long distances with fair accuracy on the basis of our mental picture of those shorter ones. For longer distances, we combine these known distance measures, but in order to do so effectively, we need markers on the way. In the painting on the screen, these markers consist of the people and trees. They become markers by virtue of what modern psychologists call the size, distance, and variance hypothesis, which Ibn al-Haytham subscribed to at least implicitly. This is best explained to geometrically. Let E in this diagram be the viewpoint from which, when standing upright with our feet at F to the left, we look at someone facing us. Assume that we know how far away he is, say 3 paces as measured by ET or FB. We've already determined that he's roughly one arm span tall, so when we see him according to the visual angle he subtends from point E at the center of the eye, where all the perpendicular rays coming from him converge. This point Ibn al-Haytham refers to as the center of sight, and the angle formed there determines how much of the front surface of the eye, and thus of the lens, will be occupied by his visual representation. By correlating the relative size of that visual representation and its corresponding visual angle to the distance the person stands from the center of sight, we now know how large he will appear to be when seen from a distance of 3 paces. Having determined that, we now know how large any object one arm span tall will appear to be from a distance of 3 paces, and we retain this knowledge in the form of the mental pictures mentioned earlier. Conversely, we know that any object one arm span tall that appears to be this size lies 3 paces away. Now move the person twice as far away to a distance of 6 paces. He'll be seen under a correspondingly smaller visual angle and will therefore appear to be correspondingly smaller. In fact, he'll look nearly half the size he did at 3 paces away. Move him another 3 paces away and he'll look correspondingly smaller and so forth for every increment of 3 paces. Continual perceptions of this sort eventually lead us to recognize how large many familiar objects of a known size should look from a wide variety of distances according to a wide variety of remembered visual angles. Not only that, but these perceptions also allow us to estimate expanses of ground according to the visual angles they subtend. Having already determined that each of the expanses of ground F, B, B, C, and C, D between the standing people here are 3 paces long, we know and remember that the expanse of ground at our feet that's 3 paces long will subtend angle F, E, B formed by the blue lines. Consequently, when we see another expanse of ground at our feet that subtends the same visual angle, we know that it's 3 paces in extent. Likewise, we know from experience that an expanse of ground 3 paces long and 3 paces away will subtend visual angle BEC formed by the red lines, whereas experience teaches us that an expanse of ground 3 paces long and 6 paces away will subtend visual angle CED formed by the green lines. Let's return briefly to Stas' painting. As you can see by the light blue line, several of the figures are at the same height as the viewpoint implicit in the painting. Let's concentrate on the 2 figures picked out by arrows, the woman in the middle and the couple behind and to the right of her. I'd estimate that from our implicit viewpoint, the woman in the middle lies somewhere around 7 or 8 meters away. I'd also estimate that she looks around 2.5 times larger than the couple to her left, according to their measure by the vertical blue line passing through them. I'd therefore judge them to be around 35 meters away. I reached this judgment on the basis of at least 3 spatial clues implicit in the painting, the relative sizes of the 2 objects, their right to left separation, and the fact that the feet of the couple are above the woman's feet. Here's the crucial point. Although the couple look around 2.5 times smaller than the woman, I nonetheless perceive them to be the same size. Here too, I perceive this tiny figure to the woman's right to be the same size as her because I perceive his distance from both us and her to be quite large. According to Ibn al-Haytham, this perception of constant actual size is based on my correlating apparent size to estimated distance and comparing the result to remembered correlations. Furthermore, when I see unfamiliar objects of the same apparent size at the same estimated distance as familiar ones whose size I know, I perceive them to be the same actual size as those familiar objects. On that basis, I can determine the actual size of objects never seen before by comparing their immediate visual representation to my conceptual representation of commensurate familiar objects. As Ibn al-Haytham explains it then, size and distance perception entail deductive judgments based on correlating apparent size and estimated distance, and then comparing the resulting correlation to known memorized sizes and distances. Because we're so used to making such comparisons and judgments, Ibn al-Haytham explains, we're no longer aware of the deductive process leading to them because we carry it out so swiftly and automatically. That's why most of us assume that spatial perception is immediate and intuitive. Here's one last example which illustrates just how dependent size perception is on context and the ambient clues provided by it. Take this landscape, which contains a wide variety of clues about distance and size. For instance, judging by the size of these stones in the immediate foreground, the largest of which I estimate to be roughly 10 centimeters in cross-section, I'd estimate this distance from the immediate foreground to the far edge of the road to be around 5 meters. Meanwhile, knowing that these are piñon trees, which are typical of the high New Mexican and Colorado deserts, I'd estimate this tree to be somewhere around 2 meters tall. On that basis, I'd guess this distance to be around 75 or 80 meters. Finally, with all these clues in mind, and with a knowledge of the terrain pictured here, I'd estimate the low mountains in the distance to be somewhere around 5 kilometers away, although the lack of markers within this range of the landscape makes that estimate extremely tentative. Now, with all these points established, let's assume that the yellow circle here represents a moderately small object placed near us in the immediate foreground of the picture. It looks to be maybe 30 or 40 centimeters in diameter in comparison to the largest stone near us. Let's move it away just beyond the edge of the road at a distance of roughly 5 meters. Even though it's precisely the same size and subtends precisely the same visual angle as before, it looks much larger because of the increased distance at which we imagine we see it. Finally, when we shift it out to a point just above and beyond the mountain several kilometers away, it appears enormous, even though its actual size remains unchanged. Armed now with what I hope is a fairly clear understanding of Ibn al-Haytham's account of distance and size perception, we're ready to conclude with a look at his explanation of the moon illusion. Actually, Ibn al-Haytham offers two complementary explanations. One, which traces back to Ptolemy and even earlier, attributes the enlargement of moon and sun at horizon to refraction through thick, humid vapors rising to a relatively short altitude from the Earth's surface. When viewed through such humid vapors along the horizon, the two bodies appear magnified in a way similar to that in which objects viewed through water appear enlarged by refraction. This is how the moon illusion was commonly understood for centuries after Ptolemy. After a careful analysis based on the principles of refraction established by Ptolemy, however, Ibn al-Haytham realized that the refractive magnification caused by humid vapors wouldn't be nearly enough to account for the degree of enlargement that the moon and sun appear to undergo at horizon. There had to be an additional, more fundamental cause, and it had to be based on something other than the physics of refraction. Ibn al-Haytham was thus ultimately driven to seek that cause in the psychology of perception, or rather misperception, and more specifically, in the misperception of distance and size. So let's take a look. Ibn al-Haytham opens his explanation with a couple of astronomical considerations. The first, which accords with the accepted cosmology of his day, is that the vault of the heavens is spherical, with its concave surface facing us. But that spherical vault is so far away, around 127 million kilometers or 10,000 times the Earth's diameter, according to the calculations of his day, that we can't perceive its distance properly because we lack any markers to help us along the way. No trees, no expanses of ground, no mountains in the horizon to help us put its distance in perspective. As a result, we can't perceive its concavity or any other spatial feature of it. All we can perceive is its blue color during the day or its star-studded blackness at night. Still, we're constrained to guess at its shape, and our best guess, according to Ibn al-Haytham, is that it forms a sort of ceiling extending high overhead and roughly parallel to the plane of the ground we stand on. This misperception is reinforced by cloud formations such as this one that seem to follow the flat contour of the sky. The second astronomical consideration is that the moon and sun move in circular orbits around the Earth and concentric with it, completing each orbit in a 24-hour day. Like the celestial vault, these orbits lie so far away that, lacking any markers along the way to define their distances, we can't detect their curvature. We therefore perceive them as straight lines along the heavenly ceiling. Consequently, both celestial bodies appear to move away from us in straight lines through the heavens, and as they do, they appear to recede ever farther from us as they move from zenith directly overhead to horizon. If they actually did recede from us along straight lines, though, they'd appear to get smaller and smaller as they receded from us because they'd subtend ever smaller visual angles. They would therefore appear to follow a pattern similar to this string of light fixtures on a ceiling viewed down a long corridor, continually decreasing in apparent size while marking out ever smaller distances as they approach the horizon. What we should see then is something like this, starting with the moon high above and then moving toward the horizon along continually decreasing distances in equal time increments as follows. This then is the final overall pattern, which is just like the one we saw earlier with the light fixtures on the long corridor ceiling. But since the moon and sun actually revolve about us in concentric circles and therefore maintain the same distance from us throughout their orbits, they subtend the same visual angle throughout those orbits. Consequently, they look as though they grow in size as they approach the horizon because their apparent distance, which is perceived according to their apparent rectilinear motion away from us along the celestial ceiling, increases while their actual size, as measured by the visual angle, remains constant. What Ibn al-Haytham is getting at is easy to grasp with the aid of a diagram. Let this represent the moon directly overhead at zenith, its actual orbit being the circular segment in white, and its apparent path along the heavenly ceiling, the straight light gray line tangent to it. The observer stands where the plane of his horizon touches the Earth's surface, and the visual angle under which he views the moon is contained by the gray lines converging at his viewpoint. When the moon passes through this part of the orbit, it'll subtend the same visual angle, but the perceived moon in gray on the rectilinear path will lie slightly above and ahead of it. After passing through a second part of its orbit, the perceived moon in gray will lie farther above and beyond the real moon and will have increased a bit in perceived size. By this time, the disparity in size between the perceived and real moon will be noticeable, and it will increase with each increment of movement along its orbit. Consequently, the closer it approaches the horizon on its actual orbit, the larger it appears to be because of a misperception of distance. Being parallel, the apparent celestial plane and the plane of horizon will appear eventually to converge, as in this picture. So when the moon reaches that point at the horizon, it will have achieved its largest apparent size, as illustrated here. This, in all its simplicity, elegance, and empirical plausibility, is Ibn al-Haytham's explanation of the moon illusion. And it was precisely because of its elegance and plausibility that this explanation, with various adjustments, was generally accepted as canonical by elite scientific thinkers until relatively recent times. Let me sum up my discussion with a few brief concluding remarks. First, the theory of size and distance perception on which Ibn al-Haytham based his account of the moon illusion is neither counterintuitive nor simplistic. On the contrary, it makes a great deal of experiential and theoretical sense, and it's quite sophisticated. More to the point, within the intellectual context of its day, Ibn al-Haytham's account was strikingly original and creative. It's important to realize, however, that it was a response to issues of distance perception raised by his adaptation of Ptolemy's visual ray theory. Second, as Ibn al-Haytham analyzes it, such perception requires a great deal of psychological intervention on the part of the perceiver. Remember that according to his theory, we don't perceive the external world directly or immediately. We do so by means of a visual representation standing between that world and us as perceivers. Furthermore, this representation is two-dimensional, not three-dimensional, so it has no depth. Therefore, our perception of space, which is contingent on our perception of such characteristics as size and distance, both of which depend on depth perception, is mediate and inferential, not immediate and intuitive. As we've seen, in fact, It's the product of deductive judgments based on a variety of clues contained in the flat visual representation. Third, these deductive judgments aren't intellectual. They're based in the imagination, which is where we see the mental images of size and distance that we've created over the course of our lives. That's why so much of spatial perception involves misperception, because the imagination is so notoriously unreliable. And that's why such misperception requires intellectual rectification through the science of mathematical optics, which occupies most of the Kitāb al-Manāthir. Yet even though we may be intellectually persuaded that the moon illusion is just that, an illusion, our intellectual awareness of this fact will not stop us from perceiving the moon as larger at horizon than at zenith. Perception, in short, is essentially autonomous. It's tied to what the visual representation tells us rather than to what our intellects tell us. Otherwise, we'd be able to reason our way out of seeing ourselves in mirrors, because mirror images are nothing but illusions, fictions of our imagination, according to Ibn al-Haytham. Fourth and finally, implied in Ibn al-Haytham's account of distance and size perception is the idea that space, as visually perceived, is a sort of fictional construct, a product of our imaginations. After all, as we've seen, Ibn al-Haytham assumes that spatial perception is ultimately based on how we sense space according to our bodies, the feeling of an arm's length distance, an arm span tall, or a pace away. How then do the two forms of spatial perception, tactile and visual, relate? Do they correspond in some fundamental one-to-one way, each somehow an accurate reflection of the other? And if so, precisely how do they reflect one another? Do they in fact represent real space, whatever that may be, in any meaningful way? Is space actually geometrical in structure, or is our imposition of geometry upon it for visual analysis a mere artifice? To my knowledge, these issues weren't raised explicitly before the 17th century, but it's clear that they lurk just beneath the surface of Ibn al-Haytham's account. In retrospect, therefore, we can't help but be impressed by how astute that account was at both the psychological and philosophical level. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Fascinating lecture. Thank you very much. I'm reading some of the questions that came through the chat box. Let me take one. I'll read it loud. Did Ibn al-Haytham use some of his own result in geometry in his work on optics? And did he comment on the use of mathematics in the study of natural phenomena? I suppose other phenomena. Mark?
Sorry. Let me get out of this screen share. Sorry. Come on. It won't. There we go. Well, no, there we don't go. Yeah, okay. No, sure. Am I out now?
Yes,
okay.
You are.
Okay.
You're out.
All right. Okay. Well, In the Kitāb al-Manāẓir, or actually I should say in Deus Spectivus, because I, as I said, I worked from the Latin, not the Arabic. Yes, in a sense, he talks about mathematics because the use of mathematics. I'm not sure I'm getting all of the things in the right order, but that's okay. Insofar as he basically talks about two kinds of approaches to optics. One is by the mathematicians, he calls them, and the other is by the naturales, or I guess natural philosophers would be the proper term. And all of that, of course, harks back to Aristotle and the distinction between the more mathematical of the mathematical sciences or the physical sciences, distinction. So yes, he's very clear about the need for mathematics, and of course that's eminently clear in the starting really with book five and going all the way through book seven, where he deals with reflection and refraction in great detail and uses geometry, by the way, not arithmetic or algebra. He uses it extensively and quite sophisticatedly. I mean, I would love to have talked about his, what's called Alhazen's problem, which you're probably familiar with, Asaf. The geometry of that is just, it's spectacular. And it's really complicated because you have to know conic sections. At least you have to know about hyperbolas, and it's just a marvel of technique. You know how he solves the Al-Hasan's problem. So I'm not sure if that's a full answer to the question that was asked, but there's no question that math is super important to him.
I have to say that I'm familiar with one of your books. This is not a question. Fascinating book. I didn't get it from you. I have it from George Saliba. This is the book that from sight to light, the passage from the ancient to the modern. It's a I'm doing some publicity for you here. It's a fantastic.
Well, thank you.
It's a wonderful book to read. Another question. I'm reading off, in your slides, the moons and the moon illusions are bigger on the horizon than further up in the sky because they are drawn bigger, not because of an illusion. Why was there apparently no illusion in your slides comparable to what we experience in the real world? What would Ibn al-Haytham have said to this if photographs, electronic images, etc., had been available in his day?
Well, I'm not sure. I could take a wild guess at the latter question, but the initial question I think is a fairly easy to address. Of course, that raises the issue of the moon illusion itself. What is it? What causes it? And the answer is nobody really knows. Many, many theories, including Ibn al-Haytham's, that was one, have been proposed all on the basis of misperception, not on the basis of the physics of refraction. And no one has come to a satisfactory conclusion. Why couldn't I not just get a photograph of the moon illusion that would show how it works? And the answer, I think it's fair to say that the answer is that we have binocular vision, not monocular. And so we don't actually, you know, experience the world, although we may, you know, Ibn al-Haytham may say that it's a flat representation. We don't experience the world completely that way. So we experience it at least in a spatial way determined by the way our binocular vision gives us a quote three-dimensional unquote sort of view of the world. And I think it's being within the world in that context with our binocular vision that we're subject to that misperception. And whereas in a photograph, because it's not binocular and we're not inside it, we don't get that same experience, so we can't experience. So I had to fake it, and I did. I will admit it. You know, I lied, but I think it was a useful lie anyway in drawing those things larger. So as far as Ibn al-Haytham is concerned, I think Ibn al-Haytham, I mean, Ibn al-Haytham understood that we had binocular vision. There's no question about that because he did a lot of study of binocular vision. And how you can misperceive depending on how your eyes focus in what direction. So again, I think he might have been satisfied with that particular explanation of why it won't show up in a photograph. I'm just not dead sure because that's really Descartes. It's not Ibn al-Haytham. So I don't want to put too much in Ibn al-Haytham's mouth. You know, I don't want to let him speak for himself.
Here's another question that you may have to speculate or lie about. What did Ibn al-Haytham know about how the brain processes the information received in the eye? That's speculation again.
Well, I know what he thought he knew. I know his theory quite well. I love the theory. Okay, so very clearly, he broke sight into phases. So there are three fundamental phases. One is just the reception of the light and the feeling of the light. Then there's And that I just call sensation. He calls it, well, in Latin anyway, amounts to brute sensation. Then there's perception, where you start to distinguish. Remember I talked about knowing blue from red. You start to distinguish among the colors, and you distinguish also among the clues in the representation, what he calls the 22 visible intentions. Two of them are light and color. And then there are other things like that even include beauty and ugliness. And we have what's called a discriminatory or a virtus distinctiva, that's the Latin anyway, a faculty of discrimination that allows us to infer these intentions. They're like clues that we have to see and pull out of the impression we get. So we see the spatial separation of things. We see, you know, all kinds of characteristics of things, including he includes beauty and ugliness, which are sort of fascinating. All of those things we sort of infer, and out of those things we form a composite picture, what he calls a particular form of, you know, the particular thing. And then seeing lots of those kinds of particular forms, like human beings, we see lots of them, we develop a general form or a universal form, as it's forma universalis, as it's called in Latin. So it's that set of phases that leads to really an epistemological, cognitive understanding of the world out of mere sensation.
The honorable question, but I'm going to ask, do we know how close the Latin version to the Arabic? Did anybody check that?
Excellent. Yes, indeed. Abdelhamid Sabra spent most of his career at Harvard editing the Arabic version, which is a mare's nest, because the Arabic manuscripts, it's a very complex. There aren't a lot of them, and most of them are very fragmentary. So for one thing, in order to establish the Arabic text, he actually had to go to the Latin text to check it, okay? And I know from his translation, I don't know from comparing the Arabic. I'd love to have, at one time in my career, I tried to do that with him, to compare the Arabic with the Latin. But I could compare his translation with the Latin in my translation. And what I found was in books, there's a bit of book one of the Arabic that's missing. Three chapters or four chapters. But then the rest that's there between books one and two is very close. They're both very close. In book three, what we get in the Latin is a paraphrase of the Arabic. But when we get into the mathematical stuff, they're very close. And I have to say, one way I know that they're very close is that, one, Ibn al-Haytham was really smart. So he knew what he was doing. He did not fake, you know, make bad propositions. How can I put this? His geometry is perfect. And the Latin is perfect. Every theorem, every proposition, and they're very complicated. Every proposition in the Latin is absolutely correct. So that you know, and I think Sabra would have agreed that he's unfortunately dead now, but I think he would have agreed that they're really close, except for that book three, which is a very strange book in Latin.
If I may follow, Sabra checked the translation, or he did some translation himself?
Oh, he translated. He did a full edition and translation of books one through five. There are seven altogether. So he never got around to six and seven. But books five and six in particular are extremely technical. Well, four isn't that technical, but book five is the most technical, I think, of all of them, because of I don't want to go into it because it's too complicated, but it's a beautiful book. It really is, mathematically.
Yeah. All right. Let me take another question I have here from the chat box. Did Ibn al-Haytham give any role to binocular vision in determining distance? Did he consider parallax?
No. I mean, not in determining distance. He certainly considered parallax because his explanation of diplopia depended on parallax, but but he never, that business of using binocular vision to determine distance, as far as I know, is Descartes, which is long after. No, I he did not use it for determining mm-hmm. distance. At least not that I, you know, that I ever got out of it.
Another question, you made the point that the light rays are refracted at the back of the lens. Can you say what he thought about refraction? For example, why does it happen and under what conditions? Did he have independent evidence that refraction did occur at the back of the lens?
Well, of course, the way he understood refraction is pretty much the way we would understand it. He understood it in terms of density. So mm-hmm. if the light rays always travel in straight lines unless they're interrupted. So say you have a light ray, since we're talking about the atmosphere here and an issue of atmospheric refraction, if we pretend that we have the magnification by refraction. So light rays come from a star through what's called the ether, which has almost no density at all. It's really great stuff. And it goes zipping along and it hits the atmospheric shell. And the atmospheric shell has fire and air in it, and it's denser than the ether. When it hits that denser thing, it's slowed down, and it then goes towards the normal. That is, it's bent kind of downward. So when light travels from a rarer to a denser medium, and we would argue kind of the same thing. We call it optical density, but we'd argue kind of the same thing. It's diverted along the normal, by which I mean, if this is the surface, this is the normal, the perpendicular. The ray comes in like this, it hits right where they join, and then it's diverted down towards the normal. So it makes a smaller angle in a denser medium, like the water, say from air to water, and vice versa. It'll do exactly the opposite thing in going from water to air. So yeah, he knew that perfectly well. Now the other issue was, I forgot, what was the second part of that question?
Let me go back to it. Let me read it. Can you say what he thought about refraction in general? For example, why does it happen and under what condition refraction happens? Was he aware of that?
Well, yeah, I think that's what I was trying to say, is that his version is that it's a kind of a physical reaction, like hitting a denser. Yeah. It's like if you hit, he actually offers a couple of examples, but one I like is taking a sword and hitting a log with a sword. If you hit it straight down, you know, you get a lot of force and it'll penetrate. But as you hit it more and more obliquely, it'll turn in your hand. And so that you know, the resistance that's made by it hitting that tends to push it towards the normal. And if it's too oblique, it'll turn out of your hand and it won't go through.
This is Mark Smith's explanation?
No. This is Ibn al-Haytham. This is not
Ibn al-Haytham himself.
Yes.
Here's another question, kind of history. Did later European scientists give credit to Ibn al-Haytham?
Up to a point, you know, up into the 17th century, yes, I think they would give Ibn al-Haytham credit. Often they gave him discredit. For example, often they gave him discredit rather than credit.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, it's Al-Hazen says blah, blah, but of course he's wrong. That's what I mean by discredit, okay? He was taken seriously up into the 17th century, and then he was obsolete. Because if you read my book, Kepler sort of stirred the waters there and made him obsolete, really.
Okay. Here's one. I only see in one eye, and I think it's more a comment. I only see in one eye, and I think I don't see the moon illusion.
And that would certainly, corroborate the guess that we need binocular vision in order to see it, because you know it's part of our feeling of being in the in the scene that we're looking at, and the binocular vision is crucial to that.
Yeah, that was not a question. I have to say that was from your own brother, George Smith, and I thought I have to quote him.
Oh well, my brother's been arguing that he doesn't see the moon illusion, which you know. Raises an issue that I think is an interesting issue is, I claim that perception is independent of intellection. That is to say, just because I know that the moon illusion is an illusion doesn't mean that I don't see the illusion, that I don't perceive the illusion. And yet he argued, and I have to say that I have some sympathy with this argument that we can adjust our perceptions by knowing stuff. Our perceptions can change within the context of our learning stuff.
Okay, so I'm looking down the list. It's a long list here. Did anyone before Ibn al-Haytham suggest that the moon illusion really was an illusion? That is, if you measure the angular size of the horizon, it would not be bigger. Anybody before him?
Well, actually, yes. Ptolemy, the place where Ptolemy talks about the magnification by refraction is in the Almagest, his astronomical work. In the Optics, he has a rather cryptic description rather than explanation of the moon illusion, that it is an illusion caused by our seeing it under abnormal circumstances. An example of seeing it by abnormal circumstances, one of the people who investigated the moon illusion and tried to figure out what caused it was a very interesting psychologist at Harvard named Edwin Boring, who was not. In the 40s, and maybe even in the early 50s, he had students look at the moon and at the horizon when they could actually see the moon illusion. He would then have them look at it while they were lying on their backs, and he even had some look while they were bent down looking between their legs. And what he found was that they didn't see the illusion when they were looking under those abnormal circumstances. So whether he got that out of Ptolemy, I don't know, but it is clear in that Ptolemaic section in the Optics that Ptolemy is saying that it is an illusion, that the moon hasn't changed size. It has something to do with your perceiving it under abnormal conditions.
Okay.
Oh, and a guy named Cleomedes too, but we won't go into that.
All right. I think I've covered, there are some questions that repeat other questions. So I'm looking at the time. I think we're done. I have to thank you very much. That was a fascinating lecture, Mark. I'm sure all of us, at least in the steering committee, appreciate very much you being with us today. Before I conclude, I would like to remind everybody that the Bisan Lecture Series is a monthly event on the second Wednesday of every month. And our next lecture will be by Professor Juliet Floyd on Wednesday, February the 8th. Professor Floyd is a distinguished philosopher of science. So thank you all. Thank you for being present today. And until next time.